guys, before we move on, if you want to practice these questions using artificial intelligence and see what mistakes you're making, what score you are likely to get in the test, I have got a great news for you. You can practice all these questions with AI on our app, LAPT Exam Practice App, which is available on iOS and Android as well. Plus, if you want to take a full scored mock test, one free full scored mock test is available in the app, or you can register on languageacademy.com.au. The scorecard you will get with the mock test will be as similar as what you'll get in the actual test, and which will make it very clear what score you are likely to get. I'll highly recommend each and every one of you to take that mock test, see what mistakes you're making, how to improve, and what other things you need to work on. Lastly, we have got our branches in Australia and in India, and we do provide online classes. If you need any help, do contact us on the numbers below. Now you can continue with the video.
Matthew Brady was an American photographer who is widely recognized as one of the pioneers of photography in American history. He was born around 1822 to 1824 and passed away on January 15, 1896. Brady is best known for his iconic photographs depicting scenes from the American Civil War. He studied under Samuel Morse, the inventor of the daguerreotype technique in America. Shakespeare's writing style is characterized by the use of stylized language and rhetorical devices. He often employed extended metaphors and conceits in his poetry, creating rich and vivid imagery. Some of his notable themes include love, power, ambition, fate, and the human condition. His works explore the depths of human emotions and the complexities of human relationships. Globalization has transformed the world economy, facilitating the flow of goods, services, and capital across borders. It has led to increased competition and efficiency, as businesses seek to expand their markets and reduce costs. However, globalization has also contributed to economic inequality, as some countries and individuals have benefited more than others. Video games have been criticized for promoting violence, addiction, and sedentary behavior. Some studies suggest a correlation between violent video games and aggressive behavior, although the causal relationship is still debated. Additionally, excessive gaming can lead to addiction and negative health consequences, such as obesity and eye strain. Maintaining a healthy immune system is essential for overall well-being. A balanced diet, regular exercise, adequate sleep, and stress management can all contribute to a strong immune system. Additionally, vaccinations can help stimulate the immune system's response to specific pathogens, providing protection against infectious diseases.
Norms and values are important concepts in sociology that shape human behavior and social interactions. Values are the fundamental beliefs that guide individuals' actions, while norms are the expectations that society has for people's behavior. In other words, values determine what is right or wrong, while norms determine what is acceptable or not.
The Renaissance was a period of cultural and artistic rebirth. The Renaissance was a period of cultural and artistic rebirth. World War II had a significant impact on global politics. World War II had a significant impact on global politics. The equation for the area of a rectangle is length multiplied by width. The equation for the area of a rectangle is length multiplied by width. Campus safety is a top priority for universities across the country. Campus safety is a top priority for universities across the country. The Declaration of Independence declared freedom from British rule. The Declaration of Independence declared freedom from British rule. Mary felt happy when she learned the results of the election. Mary felt happy when she learned the results of the election. Our tutorial will take place on the second floor in room 1. Our tutorial will take place on the second floor in room 1. It is interesting to observe the development of language skills of toddlers. It is interesting to observe the development of language skills of toddlers. The result of the experiment indicates that further research is needed. The result of the experiment indicates that further research is needed. Photosynthesis is essential for plant growth and development. Photosynthesis is essential for plant growth and development. In 2012, after reviewing the evidence, the American Medical Association released a major statement: nightlight can disrupt your sleep cycle. However, for whatever reason, not many people have been since informed about it. So here is the basics of what you need to know. When you're exposed to a significant amount of light, specifically of the blue wavelengths, your body suppresses melatonin production to make you feel more awake. Normally, this evolutionary design works pretty well. With the coming of night and day, our melatonin levels waxes and wanes, giving us a circadian rhythm. However, since the invention of artificial lights, we're being exposed to more and more light at nighttime, and these effects can be pretty big. Here's what happens when you place participants in a room with similar brightness to your average household. This is where their melatonin levels would normally be if they were sleeping in a dark room, and here are their melatonin levels in that lit room. You can see the huge suppression of melatonin, and it doesn't take too much to see these effects either.
We make our countertops with quartz, our clothes with cotton, our windows with glass, and our streets with asphalt because water can't dissolve these materials. They're made mostly of molecules with no charged parts. It would be silly to build, say, windows with something that can dissolve in water, like sugar. Unless you're going to eat them. And lots of the substances that water does dissolve, like washable markers, are things we engineered so that they can be washed away. We've also engineered versions that aren't dissolvable in water for when we don't want them to be washed away. By making sure water dissolves what we want it to and only what we want it to, we've been able to adapt a life to a world in which water dissolves so much stuff. We humans also literally adapted to a world in which water dissolves so much stuff. The outer layer of our skin is built in a way that makes it uncharged and therefore undissolvable. And the membrane surrounding each of the cells inside us has a similar undissolvable layer. The only reason we humans exist at all on this watery planet, or that trees, fish, bacteria, or anything else exists, is that we evolved barriers that could keep water from dissolving us into goo. Any life forms that didn't were simply dead in the water. Who is a person who gives evidence in court? Who is a person who gives evidence in court? Witness.
Which is the largest fish in the world, whale or shark? Which is the largest fish in the world, whale or shark? Whale. What do we call the condition that people cannot sleep? What do we call the condition that people cannot sleep? Insomnia.
Where is the largest tropical rainforest in the world located? Where is the largest tropical rainforest in the world located? Amazon rainforest. What is the ocean on the west of America? What is the ocean on the west of America? The Pacific.
Who is known for the theory of relativity? Who is known for the theory of relativity? Albert Einstein. Before we consider international environmental law and climate change, we need to consider domestic legislation, as it is within the sovereign states that international law is put into practice. This reflects the environmentalists' maxim, think globally and act locally. United Kingdom legislative control over the impacts of man's activity on the environment is not new. As long ago as the reign of Charles II, the main concern was the production of smoke from the burning of sea coal. Almost all areas of trade and industry were subject to very detailed legislative controls at that time, although some were governed by self-regulation in the form of guilds, which regulated both supply and methods of production. However, the measures implemented were mostly ineffective because then, as now, the specifying of legal duties and standards without providing any appropriate enforcement merely indicated good intentions but were of little practical effect. The next stage was prompted by the Industrial Revolution with the urbanization of society and its profound effects on the environment. Local industrialists used the Adam Smith model to maximize their economic benefit, but this was to the detriment of the local environment with the operation of Gresham's law, that is, the bad drives out the good. Those industrialists who were concerned for either the health of their employees or the local environment faced higher costs than their competitors. The result was the need for increasingly comprehensive statutory controls on the discharge of pollutants into various receiving media.
In late 1990s, when management consultants wrote books with titles such as The War for Talent, etc., there was a great deal of talk about the talent wars. And I think that was the bursting of the bubble with the bursting of the dot-com bubble and a sense of the people who had been the masters of the universe just a few weeks before were out on the streets looking for jobs. I think this created a reaction, it gave me ideas that there was a war for talent. In fact, all of things we saw in the late 1990s are reasserting themselves now. All those shortages are reasserting themselves, and the real reason the auditing was really the bursting of the bubble, not the shortages of talent. There are very profound structural forces which are creating these talent shortages. One is the fact that the nature of the economy is changing, it's putting more and more premium upon intellectual skills, analytical skills, creative skills, which are in short supply. So, there is a demand increase, but there is also a decrease in supply. Because we are seeing now the aging of the baby boom, the shirking of populations in Europe and Japan and not very long in China as well, and the sort of stabilization of the population of the United States, so we see a time when there is a greater demand for intellectual skills and slowing down in the supply of people who possess those skills, and also a mismatch between the sort of things that people are learning at school and university and the sort of things the economy is placing a premium on. Particularly with the shortage of trained people in the sciences and engineering. So for all sort of reasons, there's a premium on talent. Paper mills had the worst of it for years as newspapers reduced pagination, went wholly digital or shut for good. The papers were able to hammer down the cost of newsprint from firms fighting for business as demand declined. Price-taking paper mills suffered in silence. Many hesitated to shut massive machines, costing hundreds of millions of dollars. That hesitance has disappeared. Mills are taking out newsprint capacity and diversifying. Norske Skog, a Norwegian pulp and paper firm, said in June it would close its 66-year-old Tasman mill in New Zealand, for example. Many mills are converting machines to make packaging for e-commerce. UPM, a Finnish firm, announced this year the sale of its Schotten newsprint mill in Wales to a Turkish maker of containerboard and packaging. For JCS Balga, a Russian mill, newsprint used to account for 70% of production, now half of what it makes is packaging.
Both men and women gained weight, but when it came to race, black women had the most rapid weight gain, followed by white women and then black and white men. The weight gain was just a few pounds, but even a slightly higher BMI is associated with weight-related health issues. Several reasons exist for the weight discrepancy between the single and married people. For example, married men and women may be less concerned about their body weight because they're no longer actively seeking a mate. Plus, married people have a regular dining partner, possibly leading to more meals. On the single side, those who are widowed or have gone through a divorce may lose weight due to stress. So while this news may not be good for the smug marrieds, it may be welcomed by Bridget Jones. The single, and very weight-conscious, Jones may actually have had the easier path to staying thin than her married friends.
I am trying here to capture the dynamics that is conventionally being associated with urbanization developments and get back once again to this question of agriculture. Once you have cities and you also, the reverse of the cities, you have countryside. You have rural areas and have this relationship with urban areas, and it needs to develop agricultural goods. And you trade with increasing industrial goods. Increasing agriculture productivity reduces labor needs and opportunities in the rural areas, pushing people towards to the cities. There is this notion that in order to have progress and development in cities, you need people. If everybody is busing growing to crops, growing food that exists, you can't have people all going into the city.
Hello. My name is David. It's nice to meet you.
Hi, I'm Jenny. It's my pleasure to meet you.
I am sorry. What was your name again?
Jenny.
So Jenny, what do you do for a living?
I work at the local school teaching English. What do you for a living?
I am also an English teacher, but I'm currently out of work.
Sorry to hear that. It has been really nice talking to you.
Yes, it was a great pleasure meeting you.
There is a lot of water on Mars, and there once was a lot of surface flowing water. You don't see it because most of it is mixed with the soil which we call regolith on Mars. So the Martian soil can be anywhere from as little as 1% in some very dry desert-like areas to as much as 60% water. So, one strategy for getting water when you're on Mars is to break up the regolith, which would take something like a jackhammer because it's very cold. It's very frozen. If you can imagine making a frozen brick or a chunk of ice that's mostly soil and maybe half water and half soil, that's what you would be dealing with. So, you need to break this up, put it in an oven. As it heats up, it turns to steam.
My best piece of advice would be to join like-minded groups. So, for example, if you're into dance, join a dance group. And you can find a lot of these on, you know, something like Meetup or some sort of app. But you want to find groups that are similar to you. And then you can build a friendship from there, because typically, if you're interested in something, those might be those type of people that you want to build a friendship with. One of my favorite quotes from Maya Angelou, I think, can apply to friendships. When someone shows you who they are, believe them the first time. So when you're building friendships with people, they're going to show you initially who they are. So trust that. And I'm a big proponent of trusting your instincts and investing in friendships that make you feel comfortable from the outset.
always try to best understand your partner's specific communication styles. A lot of times we'll take it personally if we notice someone's avoiding us or they're communicating with us less frequently than we'd like, and this doesn't mean that they don't care about you or they don't respect you. This is likely how they were modeled communication as a child. Your partner's communication style typically comes from how their caregivers communicated with each other. You should feel comfortable asking your partner, "How do you best handle conflict?" Also, some people struggle with verbal communication, so if that's the case, you may want to ask your partner to write down what they're feeling. And this way, they won't feel so overwhelmed. Finally, know that communication requires compromise. So if you have a completely different communication style from your partner, know that it's going to be a work in progress until you figure out how you're both best going to communicate.
How would you define reasonable as it is used in law? For example, you are allowed to use reasonable force when defending yourself. It seems to depend on how serious the situation was, whether it was possible to resolve it by peaceful means, whether you were ready to try those means, and, finally, the relative strengths of those involved. Now, most men know, and they've probably grasped this from their earliest years in the school playground, that, when it comes to blows, fights don't stop until one of you is in no shape to do any damage to the other. The criteria mentioned seem a bit fuzzy to me. How can you convince a jury you were ready to try and talk your way out of it when the other person would have none of it and… Besides, he was quick to land the first punch? Also, you can strike the first blow and still plead self-defense. Of course, you again have the problem of convincing people that the threat was so great that you had no alternative, apart from getting beaten up yourself. Reacting calmly and rationally to a perceived threat is not easy to do.
Randall Jarrell, the great American critic and poet, once defined the novel as an extended piece of prose fiction with something wrong with it. Now, nothing is perfect, and you don't have to look very hard to find something wrong or perhaps just something you don't like about any work of fiction you care to name. Where, we might ask, does the editor come into this? And is it beneficial to an author to have an editor who is also a novelist? You would think that being a writer themselves, familiar with the process of writing a novel and its demands, they would be able to get inside the head of the author and be sympathetic and understanding of what needs to be done. This is not an unreasonable assumption to make. However, is it not possible that there is an opposite side to this? Editors might, from their experience as writers, possibly unconsciously, try to make over the submitted novel as they themselves would have written it. The ideal, one supposes, is for the editor to see the book through the author's eyes, but if they apply their own creative talent to the job, they might end up seeing it too much through their own eyes and, in this way, take no account of the author's original intentions.
Why is lying to ourselves a problem? We need to tell ourselves the truth when we can, for the simple reason that we often pay a very high price for the short-term calm of our lives. We miss key opportunities for growth and learning. We're not very nice to be around. We develop harmful systems. And not least, the truth will out. When we don't let it emerge, it has a tendency to reveal itself through involuntary, often physical symptoms. We become insomniac or impotent. An eyelid starts twitching. We acquire a stutter and scream in our sleep and lose energy. We fall into depression. We owe it to ourselves to dare to start to confront.
If Wikipedia had been around a couple hundred years ago, we probably would have had an article that says that the sun revolves around the earth, because that was what we understood to be true. We no longer understand that to be true thanks to advances in science and physics. But if tomorrow we were to wake up and learn that in fact time being relative really does upend the way that we think about the world, Wikipedia would have to evolve in order to describe that. So we're not really in the business of truth or facts, we're in the business of what is known, and what has been determined through consensus, scientific consensus, or otherwise. And I think that that actually provides some clarity on how to understand what information you're looking at. One thing that I think is really unique about Wikipedia is there's only one version for the whole public. There's no feed that's curated for you or for me. We all are looking at. The female spider can choose when to cut off intimate relations by eating her partner or kicking him out. This dynamic has led males to an unlikely strategy to make sure they have some say in the matter, self-castration. Males are able to leave part or all of their organ inside of a female, which decreases the odds the female will be able to mate again. But new research shows that when a male leaves his whole kit and caboodle behind, his likelihood of fathering the next batch of eggs is much higher. Why? His parting gift keeps on giving, even after he is gone. This remote copulation technique actually boosts the amount and speed of sperm transferred to the female. The behavior is described in the journal Biology Letters. So for these unlucky fellas, it is better to have loved and lost.
It would be useless as human birth control, of course, but the difference is that most female insects completely change their behavior after sex. For example, some mosquitoes suck blood. Others lose interest in males and start laying eggs. What's behind this dramatic change in behavior? Turns out it's a peptide in the male's seminal fluid. and now researchers in Vienna have found the female's receptor for this peptide. They report online in Nature that fruit flies without the receptor lay many fewer eggs and continue to be interested in sex. In other words, they act, so back to pest control. Most female insects should have this sort of receptor, including the kinds that spread disease and devastate crops. If we could deactivate it on a large scale, instead of fighting egg-laying bloodsuckers, we could live in peace with born-again virgins.
Economic development needs to be supported by the government. Economic development needs to be supported by the government. The department will continue to offer 3 new scholarships next year. The department will continue to offer 3 new scholarships next year. Food that contains antibiotics provides little or no nutritional value. Food that contains antibiotics provides little or no nutritional value.
The marketing budget has doubled since the beginning of the year. The marketing budget has doubled since the beginning of the year.
Now crack your PTE sitting at your home. Language Academy brings to you the smartest AI-powered practice portal. Along with the practice questions, access free sectional and full mock tests, and get instant scorecard with in-depth feedback and analysis. For more hidden secrets, tips, strategies, and proven templates, click the link below and subscribe to our video course today.